Welcome after a very long day, a very, very long day. I think it needs really a highlight to motivate everybody to stay here. The organizers wisely organized this kind of highlight to motivate everybody. The authors of a book that will be celebrated here about the mediated construction of reality were not quite confident if their main title would actually fit. And in order to prove that this actually a mediated construction of reality, one of the author is here in quite a mediated way. Welcome Nick Couldry, somewhere out there. His perspective is really interesting. You see him down there. Hi, welcome to everybody.
So sorry, I can't be with you in the house. This is sharp, enjoying the champagne.
You have none over there? Okay. My role is almost done. I'm supposed to say welcome to you and to those being out there, and to introduce Andreas Hepp and Nick Couldry, who have recently published this book. And the whole idea about it is just to have a kind of celebration of the launch. And for those who didn't read it so far, give a short insight into what you were trying to do and what you actually have done. The idea is that Nick and Andreas will shortly present the book, and then we will have two commentators, Giselinde Kuipers and Hubert Knoblauch, who will then afterwards comment on this book. So have fun, and the floor is yours.
Thank you very much. Well, the idea here at this conference was, or is, to present also that book, The Mediated Construction of Reality, do a book launch for Germany of that book, which was partly my work or collaboration together with Nick as part of this creative unit. In this very short introduction, we want to give you an outline about, well, the book itself, what the argumentation of the book is. First of all, I will tell you a bit about the reason why we called this book The Mediated Construction of Reality, and then how it links to our idea of deep mediatization. And afterwards, Nick Couldry will continue with some considerations about the materialist phenomenology, which we tried to develop within that book. The Mediated Construction of Reality. We wrote this book referring back to another book which was published 50 years ago with the title The Social Construction of Reality by Berger and Luckmann. And it's worth to look back to that book to get an impression what has changed over the last 50 years. One of the core arguments within that book by Berger and Luckmann was that a social construction of reality very much depends on language, or how they also call it, on everyday conversation. Maybe the most prominent quote out of the book is the quote you can see over there, where they argue that this everyday level of social reality is brought up by a conversational apparatus that ongoingly maintains, modifies, and reconstructs his subjective reality. Within our book, we try to start from the fundamental idea Berger and Luckmann had. This is to get a certain understanding how the construction of reality takes place, but to reflect the original questions for these times of deep mediatization. So the starting point for the book, and here you can see the first, well, sentences of the book, is to reflect about how we should or might describe processes of social construction nowadays when they are so deeply interwoven with media. Something Berger and Luckmann did not have in mind at all. What you can see over there is an outline of the book, the contents. So we really start with, in the first part, with reflecting about the construction of the social world as such, then continue in the second part with reflecting the various dimensions of the social world, space, time, and instead of knowledge data. And the third part of the book has the aim to reflect on agency in the social world. On the one hand, reflecting on itself, then on collectivities, and finally on how social order is produced beside others by organization. The book itself very much refers to what we are or were discussing here at that conference up to now, and this is deep mediatization. So the quote I had in the beginning of my presentation today about what deep mediatization means is out of this book. So it is the argument that we can only understand our social reality at present if we really have in mind that it is, or that it is deeply interwoven with media. Referring here back again to Berg and Luckmann and the quote I presented in the beginning, you get a feeling, a quite good feeling, what changed since these times. And in core, we can argue that the fundamental idea to move the direct communication, that face-to-face communication without a relation to media, to the core of social analysis, does not work in this way anymore. In contrast to that quote by Berg and Luckmann you can see over there, we must reflect the processes of social construction in reference to a media environment which can be characterized by what we call the media manifold. So you can see here at least four points where, or what are the reasons why we cannot move this idea of the direct face-to-face communication anymore so much in the center of social theory. This means, first of all, if we reflect about everyday direct communication nowadays, the media are already one main resource of processes of social construction within them. Second, of course, we have a multiplicity of mediated communication, so this variety of various different kinds of media we have to reflect when we want to analyze processes of social construction. But very often we have a parallel communication of different kinds of media in social situations, which you can also follow here at a conference like that with a parallel Twitter communication, but which also nowadays usual, for example, with social TV and comparable phenomena. And last but not least, there are datafied constructions of the social, so processes of social construction where we as humans have delegated whole processes of making sense to certain kinds of media technology. And this was the reason for us why we tried to outline within that book a new kind of starting point to reflect about a kind of media sociology or social theory of media, and core of it is what we call the materialist phenomenology, and this is the point where Nick will continue.
Okay, thanks. And I'm assuming you've switched the slide to the next slide. Okay, well, I'm sorry I can't be with you. I can see dimly through a sort of fog various friends at the distance, so I wish I was there, but there are lots of concepts I could be unpacking. And I could obviously spend 5 or 10 minutes just improvising on the very fact that I'm speaking to you in this way, with emails flashing in on the bottom of my screen, my phone going, reading from a printout of slides, which I can't see, but I trust are being shown to you, and so on and so on. But instead, I just want to talk a little bit about what our overall project, this book, was, and how, in particular, it relates to a very difficult area, which is the area of data and datafication, which I think potentially poses fundamental problems for the project of thinking about the social construction reality. So as Andreas said, the project of our book is to build a materialist phenomenology. And by the way, can we just check whether you're not getting a sort of feedback, because I can hear myself twice. Can you hear me three times? Is it okay? All right, good. I'll just keep going. So the project is to build a materialist phenomenology of the social world, of a mediated social world. And it's very clear that the natural starting point for Berger and Luckmann, which as Andrew has pointed out, it's conversation between two individuals seeing each other face to face, or maybe mediated by a telephone, just isn't good enough anymore. as a starting point for understanding the mediated social world that we live in and how it is constructed as it were. And one reason for that is that our lives are now embedded in platforms and infrastructures in a way that has no previous parallels with the small elements of mediation which were taken for granted by Berger and Luckmann. So if we can move to the next slide, please. What we need is a materialist phenomenology of the social world that takes account of that process of platforms and the whole infrastructure through which we are present to each other. And this actually has some precedents. So we can look back to Georg Simmel's book, actually a piece that he wrote in the early 20th century, published in 1971, but really a century ahead of its time, when, as you can see, he wrote that the world of sociability is in fact an artificial world. And he wrote then that if we now have the conception that we enter into sociability purely as human beings, that is, as that which we really are, it's because modern life is overburdened with objective content and with material demands. So Simmel already saw 100 years ago this paradox that what seems most natural and direct to us is precisely what is most mediated. And that is something that we need to develop into a materialist phenomenology of the social world. And here we're taking a turn that is slightly different, at least from some voices in STS, actor network theory, by no means all. But not all of those voices have seemed to be very, find social phenomenology very congenial. And we want to strike a different balance because we want to insist that the social world remains, in spite of its mediation, it remains and it must remain. And this is an ethical point in the end. It must remain something accessible to interpretation, accessible to our understanding as embodied human actors, because the social world is precisely a structure that's built up in part through those interpretations and understandings. And that means that we have to think of what and deal with the problems of classic phenomenology in dealing with an infrastructure as deep as datification, which we now take for granted. And that's what we try to address, if we can turn to the next slide, in chapter 7 of the book. Let's work through what the problem is in the classic Berger and Luckmann approach, if they were still trying to work on the problems we face and take for granted today. The classic thesis of social construction of reality assumed, of course, that we could build from up our account of common sense knowledge simply from what we as actors know and come to understand in everyday life. And we can do that, they thought, because we express that knowledge in how we talk to each other face to face. That was an unproblematic assumption for them. But it's not an unproblematic assumption for us. And why exactly is that? Well, first of all, because our lives are saturated with data processes which measure us, support us in our interactions, enable us to enter infrastructure systems that we need to buy tickets and so on and so forth. Those processes, those systems are based on automated forms of collecting, aggregating, interpreting data. And those data processes are driven by goals which are external to our goals as social actors. They're much larger macro goals than ours. And yet, this wouldn't be a problem if we saw that all as distant infrastructure that somehow we could interpret from a distance and that had no impact on how we knew the social world. But of course, we know that those data processes are also generating a form of social knowledge themselves. They are a key part of how we know the social, how we think the social is known anymore, how it's even knowable. And that means that we're living a fundamental challenge to the key premise of Berger and Luckmann's phenomenology, which is, to quote them, that everyday life presents itself as a reality interpreted by men or women and subjectively meaningful to them as a coherent world. That just isn't true in a simple way anymore. So that's where we have to start from. And we can turn to the next slide. We have to think about the detailed paradoxes and tensions that this gives result to. Just to illustrate one of them, it's the tension of opacity. We know the datified world is partly opaque to us. That's one of the problems we have to deal with. Now, in fact, what we could say a bit more about that. Oscar Gandhi's written about how it's not just opaque, but it actually discriminates against us very often. It categorizes us in a way that has social consequences. It remakes the world in certain ways which benefit some people, not others. We live under general conditions of opacity, as Julie Cohen points out in her legal theory. So those are the points that we know we have to deal with. And yet at the same time, we can't say this is a new problem for social theory. In fact, and it's interesting, Schutz and Berger and Luckman already anticipated a problem that the world, the social world, is not always totally transparent to those who live within it. But let's look at how they thought the problem could be solved. For them, the problem was just one of partial knowledge. We can't know everything at the same time. It takes time to find out what we need to know. Therefore, we have to wait till we talk to the right person. And then they show, well, you needed to know that as well, and therefore the problem of opacity is resolved. But as Schutz puts it, the life world is experienced as only relatively intransparent. But in principle, it is transparent in the end. Now, we know that simply does not capture the way in which the datafied world is opaque to us. We, however long we live and however hard we try, we will probably never know how Google's algorithms will work in the next minute or the minute after that, because they're constantly changing in an interactive way beyond the full control of the very engineers who designed the process of building them. So that's one problem of deep fundamental opacity, which contradicts the traditional phenomenological approach, unless it's fully materialist. The other problem is, of course, is that datification is a non-reversible process. It transforms the social world in a way that can't be unwritten. So as Joseph van Dyck puts it in her wonderful book, The Culture of Connectivity, it's easier to encode sociality into algorithms than to decode algorithms back into social action. And that opens up a very difficult question, which is, what are the consequences of datification at many levels for the social world, seen still as a social construction in some fundamental sense? And that, for us, is core to understanding the nature of platform power. If we can move to the next slide, please. Just moving to one other example of the tension here, which we think the result of this is a very deep change in our relations to infrastructure. I mean, philosophers have been thinking about tools since Plato and certainly since Heidegger and saying a lot about them. But there's a new situation we're dealing with which philosophers have not yet dealt with, which is that our tools, our digital tools, are black boxes that are not only available for us to use them, but in the very moment of us using them are already using us. They have already been counting up and observing our actions, categorizing us. In the very moment in which we were able to use them, this must already have happened. This is what we call in the book tool reversibility. The tools work two ways. They have already been using us as we become able to use them. And that reverses, again, the situation that Schutz saw, which is he saw tools, which are material objects, as one extreme of how we work with artifacts. We use artifacts to typify the world. But this is the opposite. Those artifacts that we use today, some of them are typifying us for commercial ends, which are not our ends. And so that's a fundamental reversal in the relationships with tools and the infrastructure built out of tools that classical phenomenology assumed. Now, the key point we make in the whole book is not that these points are totally new or not already anticipated in some way in active network theory and so on and so forth. Of course they are. But they're only really visible as tensions, as difficulties for the lives we lead. It's the sort of tensions we feel as tensions from a phenomenological perspective, because there's only that perspective that foregrounds problems of meaning within what we emphasize are ever more intense relations of interdependence, dependent on system. And that, of course, once we emphasize that tension between meaning and system, it's an old tension, but it brings into view a new space of conflict, which is intrinsic to the world of deep mediatization. So the challenge is to try and understand deep mediatization as an overall social process, which is enacted through countless figurations. We could say more about that concept if we had time. but bringing various ethical and other challenges inevitably with them. So, for example, Facebook is a figuration, a very complex one, which is both an infrastructure and a site, infinite series of sites, where we practice meaning. It's both together. We can't understand it unless we think about both. And it's seeing this doubleness of our relationship to certain types of figuration that brings in Norbert Elias's very subtle late work on how we live relations of interdependence, which we talk about a lot in the book. So moving towards the conclusion, because we want to very much hear what our respondents are going to say about the book, Giselinde and Hubert, let me just end with one broader point. If we could go to the final slide, please. I want to just say a little bit about what's at stake, not so much in our theory. We may have got it wrong, you may disagree with it, but in trying to get the theory right, in trying to do social theory that's adequate to this complexity that we're actually living today. And for us, this isn't just a descriptive or analytic matter. Of course, we're professionals, we want to try and get it right, just as we all do. But there's something much more at stake here for us than just doing the analysis right. And what's at stake is this being adequate to the normative tensions which we're all now living in these relations, these very new relations with infrastructure. These tensions are not trivial. They're not those that only bother academics who have the luxury to think about them. They are lived tensions that writers such as Sherry Turkle pick up in the everyday talk of young adults. We pick up them at all ages, all classes, right across the world. And so we need to register them really seriously in our social work and with the right sort of social theory that can register them. So let's just end with a final reference to Elias, where we found to our surprise that he too was picking up this ethical commitment in getting social theory right. As he wrote nearly 40 years ago, people often seem deliberately to forget that social developments have to do with changes in human interdependence. If no consideration is given to what happens to people in the course of social change, which are changes in the configurations composed of people, then any scientific effort might as well be spared. In other words, it matters to register the complexity and the pain and the joy of our relationship with technology and infrastructures, but we can only fully do that from a phenomenological perspective, and that in the end is an ethical choice of a sort. So I think that's enough from us, and we're very interested to hear what Giselinde and Hubert will say about our book, and then if I'm still allowed by technology to remain in contact, I'll look forward to making a few comments at the end. Thank you for listening.
First of all, it's a great honor to be here and to be invited to speak. I'm also very impressed that you're all still here after this long day. I think it must be a stroke of genius on the part of the organizers to put everyone up so far away. Otherwise, I'm not sure if you would all have been here. But I want to thank especially Nick and Andreas for inviting me to read their book, because I've enjoyed it greatly. And people, this is a very important book. I think I'm quite sure you will cite this book within the next 5 years several times, and not only if Andreas is your thesis advisor, but then, of course, too. So what this book does is try to rethink social theory in an era of mediatization, or rather to combine media theory with social theory to find common ground to bridge it. And that is actually a very important thing that needed to be done for a long time. And because I'm a sociologist, a cultural sociologist, I've been working on media, and I found this a serious problem in the sense that it's very difficult to combine the two. So like most people on this sort of divide, I find myself sometimes engaging with media theory, sometimes with social theory, but never being able to combine it. And I think looking at the field, this is a general problem, because if you look at the way that media studies has dealt with issues of social theory and general social forces and social processes, it has usually not been very sophisticated. On the other hand, if you look at the way that social theory has dealt with media, that has been a disgrace, I would say. So there is a problem there on both sides, and I think this book comes up with a very surprising way to solve that issue. And it was especially surprising to me because I am from the University of Amsterdam. This is where Norbert Elias spent his final decade. So there was a school of figurational sociology, and it had never occurred to me that figurations would actually be the right concept to solve this issue of how to combine media thinking with social thinking. But then when I heard it, it made immediate, very intuitive sense to me, and it does indeed work surprisingly well. For those of you who don't know Elias, he's, I think, the closest theorist to compare him with would probably be Pierre Bourdieu. So this is as early as the 1970s. Elias and Bourdieu had formed a mutual admiration society. But the concept of figuration in field is, I think, subtly similar but subtly different, with figuration, I would say, actually being the more radical, because it's very processual, it's very relational, and if you really try to work with it, it really requires to rethink everything that you do. And this is what this book also tries to do. So what it is, it's been explained already by Nick and Andreas, it's really a social theory that integrates media into it, or a media theory that integrates phenomenological theory. It is phenomenological, that has already been said, with not only figurations, but also the notion of figurations of figurations. So it adds a number of layers to this understanding of the shifting figurations that are made up not only of people, but also of media. And it's materialist. And that is, so the second addition, apart from the figurations, the second addition to this understanding is materialism. In this sense, I think it takes up the challenge of actor network theory and Latour to think about things and how they work in everyday life, but also, I would say, in a convincing and a critical way, and I think it outdoes Latour there. So, that, well done. So, obviously, this is very ambitious, and the one thing that I want to point out that I really very much appreciated about this work is that at the same time, it's really short, so it's only 220 pages, so I thought there must be a lot of cutting that has happened there, but still it has a lot of empirical grounding. So it uses throughout a number of examples from many different studies, from many places in the world, from many different fields. So it's a work of theory, but it's constantly referring to empirical work, which I think is quite an achievement. So did it succeed in all these great goals? Well, for me, the proof of the pudding is in the eating. So I read this book with, in the back of my mind, a problem that I've been struggling with for the past 5-6 years. My research project that I'm currently working on is on beauty, so the development of beauty standards. And clearly there is a strong sense that it has become more important to be beautiful today than it was 50 years ago or 150 years ago. This seems very intuitive. It's actually very, very difficult to prove or to give evidence. But as far as that is true, it must have to do something with media, but also very early media, photography, new forms of painting, reproduction, without saying that the media has proved it. So this was my question that I had in the back of my mind. Does this book help me understand this process of beauty becoming more important? Because that is, I think, one of the issues of social construction, mediated construction of reality in a very deep way. Well, does it succeed? Yes, I think it does on many levels. First, it succeeds because it's short. I think that's really important. And it's short without losing depth and content, which I think is really very impressive, and something that is not very often noticed, but I think I would like to mention. It's also, I have it's very well in quotations. So I think this is because I was thinking this book will be cited as quotation marks, deep mediatization, quotation marks, parentheses, Couldry and Hepp 2016. Parentheses. I think this is how I'm afraid much of this will live. And this book really is very precise in its referencing, which is not very often said, but this is, if I would want to write a review, I think this is something that it's very specific in saying we got this here from this place and this specific argument. I think that's, it's also very convincing in its rethinking of classical phenomenology in its relation to deep mediatization. Especially in the first part, it looks at space and time. But just at the time, at the moment when I was thinking, okay, so this is phenomenology and it works too in a time of media, sort of same old, then something really radical happens. And this is actually what Nick just said. Then the chapter on datification happens. And that adds a very new layer to this understanding of phenomenology, and then there are chapters on the self and on community collectivities that are really, really transform the way you think about things. I think that's really impressive, and I think it's the datification that makes it into a very deep sort of rethinking also of social theory that worked very well, and that's actually quite radical. So also in terms of my question, does this help me understand why beauty has become more important? I think it did in a number of different ways, specifically in the part where it says the self is becoming a different thing, collectivities is also becoming a different thing, and also the way we relate to the different mediated technologies really changed the way that we're perceived. So it's also a feedback loop that is introduced there in understanding that connects very closely with the findings from my own research. And I think this is what the book is supposed to do. So it works. So I can tell you, for me, it really worked in seeing things that I hadn't seen and sort of putting things together that I hadn't done so before. So a good book. There are a number of questions that I would like to ask you, or maybe some considerations that I would like to hear you reflect upon. One of the things is that even though you are very much specific, especially introduction and the conclusion, in pointing out the processual nature, I think it's very difficult at times not to read this as a before-after story. And I can see how this also is a result of trying to put so many different things and so many different literatures into the book. But this is, I think this is also how it may live on, as I said, sort of deep mediatization, parentheses. So the question that I have is what could research stemming from this book do to sort of destabilize or call into question this sort of before-after frame, sort of we had Berger and Luckman world, and then we have Couldry and Hepp world. And so that was a change, and everything is different. And I think this is, especially if you take Elias seriously, I think there is, it would be much more processual, but how could we sort of further dig into this processual nature of this transformation? And then the second question I had has also to do with the Elias framework. I think in the end, this still very much is a work of phenomenology. And this means that some of the contributions of Elias, or especially the other factors that are driving social change, such as relationships between groups, power balances, are not as present there as I would have liked. So I think this is one of the other things that maybe that could be developed more in work following up, because that's actually also a challenge. So how do these different phases of mediatization, how are they related to the sort of other social processes that would have to do with changing power balances and inequalities? Because that, I think, would be the primary driver of social change in a sort of purely figuration or Eliasian perspective. The third is the way all these processes turn back upon the material. So the material now is part of the perspective, so it's a materialist phenomenology, but the question that's not there, so you show how it changes the self, show how it changes collectivities, but I would assume this also turns back on the material, on the world, on the physical surroundings, even on, you know, things like climates, cities, physical infrastructure. I think the book actually invites sort of this further step as to how it affects other interdependencies, not only between humans and their media, but also between humans and everything else. And then the final challenge, and I'm very happy that Nick already cited the wonderful Elias quote about the sort of the moral imperative of being a sociologist. Of course, Elias's first book was The Civilizing Process, and I think it's a very good idea also in terms of sort of selling Elias to the world not to use the term civilization too much and not to refer to this book. But it does present an interesting challenge. So the basic sort of narrative of The Civilizing Process, so the book that he wrote in the 1930s, is a narrative where people become more interdependent over longer distances with larger groups of people. As a result of this, they're forced to think about other people, to take their opinions into account. And as a result of this, people become more civilized in the sense that they try to control their emotions more, that they become more aware of their emotions. So these are the steps that Elias traced. And at the end, I find myself wondering, so what if you extend this line of reasoning to a society or a condition of deep mediatization? And you can actually see this going two different ways. So one would be interdependencies will also extend towards datafied selves, machines, technology, all the others. So that would be one. And then the civilizing process would sort of continue in the terms that we would now also take into account what machines do to us, what media do to us, what data do to us. So there would be an extension. But you could also imagine actually a partial breakdown on the basis of the same mechanism. So if we become more, we identify more with machines, with specific forms of media, with specific data, then maybe relations with others would break down. And I would be interested to hear your thoughts. And of course, this is speculation, and that is something that we may not want to do. But it's interesting that you can think about these consequences in terms of civilization under conditions of deep mediatization, because that's, I think, also the normative or the ethical question that the book presents us with. So it's not only a work of theory, but it's also a work of ethics, I think, much more than it seems at the beginning. Okay, well, thank you.
Thank you, Giselinde, for this presentation. I'm not sure if I want to review the book, and I've actually took it as rather a baptizing ceremony of having a new book welcome to the world. And the difference being only that books are born adult, and this book is very adult, as you may have learned. And it's so much adult that I feel like a brick in my head. I don't know if this is the result of materialist phenomenology. I'm afraid it's rather the result of a flu which I'm suffering, and I'm really having a brick in my head. I had to write down a text in a little bit less ossified state of mind. So I'm going to read this text I was preparing, anticipating that my flu won't recede today, unluckily so. Already when reading the preface of the book by Andreas and Nick, I was reminded of a notion coined by the novelist Robert Musil, which plays an important role in his Man Without Qualities, Mann ohne Eigenschaften. As you may remember, Ulrich, the main character, participates in what has been called the Parallelaktion, or the collateral campaign, a committee founded in Vienna, secretly planning the Austrian Emperor Franz Joseph's 70th birthday, to happen in 1918, paralleled by a committee in Germany planning the 30th anniversary of throne accession by his fellow Emperor Wilhelm II. In a similar vein, the book of Andreas and Nick seemed to me when opening, like a collateral campaign to a project I have myself been contacting in parallel, which is a book called The Communicative Construction of Reality. Both books have been conceived in the early 2010s, and it is a proof of the parallel action that my book was come to, into being only a few weeks after the book by Andreas and Nick, albeit in German. There's more parallel action, for example, figuration of refiguration, but please let me stick to this one. Because of these parallels, and because I only knew about the book's content before by a short presentation of Andreas in Vienna, I was understandably very curious reading The Mediated Construction of Reality. It made a surprise that I read it in a manner constantly comparing it to what I've been writing, and what I found have been similarities and differences. One of the differences is, Giselinde, you said it, my book is, of course, much thicker. Too thick, of course. And also, of course, I have to admit, my book is really Teutonic. It's really, you need a good Protestant to read it, a barbarian Protestant. It is real work. Whereas your book is really well-read, fluent, a pleasure to read. So you can be Catholic, well, even without religion, in order to read. You need not even be a scientist, a social scientist, I'm happy to say. What I found in the book, too, is an enormously rich theory of how society is changing due to the recent wave of mediatization. It supports its thesis with probably the most encompassing view on the empirical studies on the mediatization of society existent. These multitude of studies are integrated in a general theory of contemporary society as coined, as had been said, by what they call the deep mediatization. A society is deeply mediatized if its basic elements become dependent on technologically based mediation. It is particularly the new digital datification by means of media infrastructures which affects contemporary society, its spatiality, and its temporality. At its basis, that is what I want to say, the very basic Schütz and Luckman call the structures of the life world. Time will be accelerated by, to quote, intensified figurations of meaningful interdependence whose medium is technologically based platforms of communication, such as the expectations to be always accessible by mail, chat, or SMS. Space will be transformed as, to quote, the primary where of the social world for many people is shifting over to the sites sustained by media platforms. Datification is transforming social knowledge in a way that action will exceed the direct capacities of human agents, thus affecting the notion of self, collectivity, and order. And as you've learned, these are the chapters of the book. Deep mediatization makes socialization independent of significant others, as George Herbert Mead has called them, so that media, they say, are becoming part of the resources of the self. Similarly, new collectivities are developing who do not require membership. And finally, social order as a relatively stable pattern of interdependencies will continuously, as they say, depend on corporations. All these tendencies, Andreas and Nick rightly argue, do not only contribute to what has been called social change in sociology, they add up by their own to a basic transformation of society and the social. It is the thesis of this basic transformation of society and the social. It is the thesis of this basic transformation that requires a reformulation of social theory in terms of communication. And it is, to come back to the beginning, this view which constitutes our parallel action. Common to us is the conviction that we need a new social theory accounting for communicative action practices as the basic processes of constructing reality. And of course, what I learned here and from Nick and from Andreas is how and to what degree the media, well, mediatization plays a role, which has been really, I admit, neglected in the social constructivist theories starting from Berger and Luckmann. There are, of course, some difference. While I would certainly stress that it is the social construction of reality, Andreas and Nick rather follow the path of Searle's construction of social reality. This way, they share a more realist view, version of reality, rather exempting nature and the natural sciences from these processes of construction. Indeed, this perspective is quite consequential, for both focus much more on the role of the media and what we would call in sociology the media system, while I would stress much more, and Giselinde has also mentioned this, the role of technology and objects, so which is the move from mechanization to digitalization as basis for what I would call the communication society. When I'd opened the book first, to be frank, I was afraid that it may challenge what I have been writing or that it may make my book superfluous. What I happily found was a book which is very much complementary to what I've been writing in a way as to address different questions, different audiences in a similar way. What it has in common throughout is a dedication to social constructivism as a theory and as a methodology, both for doing theory and for considering and reflecting empirical research. It proves that a movement called social or communicative constructivism contributes to what one could call an open theory, which evades a pre-major dogmatism and scholastic attitude by theoretically and empirically reflecting its own constitution in communicative action. Thus, the mediated construction of reality to me is not just a parallel action for an emperor who has lost the war and abdicated. It is rather a book venerating the emperor without clothes, at least if you take this fairy tale to be an expression of a view that takes power and reality, also scientifically researched reality, in general as a result of social construction, and to add more than just an individual psychological construction. As being a determined contribution to social constructivist view on reality, the book, to my mind, has also an important political impact. It allows to understand and to reconstruct the reification of socially well, digitally, datafied, mediatized construction of realities and its subsequent mystification by naive realists, neo-ontologists, and outside of academia, new populists. The book is not only an expression against reificatory movements, it also provides a strong explanation why such movements came about. We may hope that it will be read widely, not only by theorists, but also by practitioners. Thank you.
Nick, shall we comment or shall we open up?
Well, why don't we take a few? I have lots of comments, but I mean, we have only 25 minutes left, I think. Is that right? So we should maybe give people an opportunity to add a few more questions.
Everybody's waiting for you, I'm afraid.
Well, otherwise we can say something to the ethical issue.
Yes, I've got something to say. Shall I try something?
Yeah.
I can't see you, Andreas, so it's hard to negotiate.
Yeah, that's fine.
All right, I'll try.
So start. You can start, I will add on.
All right. Thank you, both of you, for very... I'm going to turn down the sound a little bit so there'll be less feedback. Okay. Thank you both for very elegant responses to the book. and it's difficult to respond in a coherent way because there's such rich responses. I think I need to think more about Hubert's very interesting contrast between the social construction of reality on the one hand, and which is the project he still holds to, and our interest in mediated construction of social. I think in the end the difference isn't so fundamental, because, but I'm not sure. I think we probably need to have a separate seminar to unpack what's at stake here. Certainly we take a realist view, and of the concept, we absolutely did not take anything like postmodern view of thinking about the result of social construction, and that we need. We try to have a many layered approach to thinking about how reality is put together, and that's important because it relates to the final section of the book, which is about order. Here I'll move to talking a bit about what Giselinde said, because I think the answer to all the excellent questions Giselinde asked is to be found insofar as it's there, final two chapters on order. What we tried to do, and this has been the opposite of my practice in all my previous books, is to abstract from questions of power for a moment, not because they're not important, but because if we start only from thinking about power differentials, which can, of course, go in multiple directions, it gets in the way of seeing how the whole space of relations is itself reconfigured. And that's the most important thing to see before we can have any theory of power into this new reconfigured space. So that's the strategy of the book, to come back to power in the last two chapters. We decide to approach the question of power, not via looking at the power of particular institutions, because obviously if you start from a relational approach, you can't extract Google, Facebook, from all the millions of billions of people across the planet to relating with them. Interrelating with each other through. So we have to think about the overall space of configurations, and that passes with the notion of figuration, and then figuration configurations enables us to do. And that has some two ways. One is we bring in the chapter of figurations and figurations, a thinking about myth and how certain sets of the way things are and have to be can be reinforced by the complex set the interrelationships which we're now bound, which we can't get out of or can be different. So that's one very important way of how reality is constructed, where power obviously comes in. So we try to deal with it there. And then in terms of the ethics of it, the last two chapters, try to ask some questions about whether the overall order, the multi-leveled order that we're now involved and entangled in, inevitably, is broadly good or broadly bad, but not trying to ask a simple question, trying to frame the sort of angles from which we think about that question. And we raised it to political order, whether the intense militarization of the political world is now debasing politics, making certain types of political reference possible. We deliberately avoid trying to reach a neat conclusion as if we could conclude we're now an uncivilizing process. Although I have to reveal that was the one early title of the final chapter before Andreas got control of me and my pessimism. But then recent events in 2016 might have changed our view of that. He wrote it in an optimistic day before June 23rd, November 7th, etc. But we did at least try to raise the question of a suitable level of generality, not to close it down, but to say that we can't talk about sense about power, order, the goodness of the life we live together, unless we understand the whole web of things and people that we are part of, which is the key point that Elias made, that you can't make simple statements or raise simple questions about this. You have to understand the level on which things are getting done in our world before you can ask questions about power. So I think going back to both Leah's, Giselinde and Hubert's point, I think it would be wonderful to have another seminar or two in the course of next year to actually start to unpack the implications of that and how one would start to build a different theorization of how this starting point, including data from the beginning. That's what we managed to complete in this book. We try and provide better, I admit, to do, and so great to do some of that collaboratively, some of you.
Okay. Yeah, well, Nick already said our core arguments on the ethical issue, which was in the end, well, this was a really long discussion we had, because it was obvious that we could not take the way Elias
yes,
had with his original idea of the civilization process, because this does not grasp the complexity anymore, which we are confronted with. But on the other hand, it was obvious for us that we cannot deliver a narration on this, that deep mediatization would result either in this or that. And this was the reason why in the last chapter we tried to problemize it from an ethical point of view, but left it open. So maybe this was a rhetorical move, but this is the only way how we could solve intellectually this problem at the moment of time when we were writing. I wanted to add something on what you both said with reification and the physical dimension of the world. So what is right, I think, within the book, when we reflected about technologies and materiality, we did it with reference to media. So there is a quite broad understanding of media within that book. Yeah? Of course, there are some kinds of technologies which are not media, but we broaden the understanding of media in the book, I think, quite a lot, while keeping it related to that media have something to do with the construction of meaning. So this is how we really made the cut. And I think that at least I would say our relations to question of the physical world is exactly this argument about reification. So there is the idea that the moments of building up media include a kind of materialization, which then can become a kind of naturalization, so that it appears to be part of the natural world, which is a certain form of reification then, which of course refers back to Berger and Luckmann at that point, but tries to radicalize that thinking. And here is, I think, is exactly the link to the question you have. But of course you're right, it is not the formulated theory at that point. Yeah? But this is, I would say, the way which is outlined in the book to theorize this kind of problem in relation to media and communications. And there, of course, yes, it is media sociology or sociology of media and communication. It is not a sociology in general. I think there are the limits of the book. We are quite aware about it. This may be as a first try to answer the questions you raised.